Hey friend, this is Philip from Pick Yourself and welcome to the second round of Send Me Your Questions, Get a Video Answer. In this little series, I'm helping the people from my audience, just like you, with their individual struggles, and you will get some kind of mini coaching via video from me. So if you have something that you currently struggle with in your artist career, that can be something with production, it can also be something with promoting your music, whatever it is, hit me up, send me an email, philip@pickyourself.com, and I would love to help you. So just write me an email and you will hear back from me with a video answer just like this one. Okay, let's jump into the question of today. So today's question is coming from James. James asks, for a studio that's focused on producing and mixing, is it worth hiring an acoustic specialist to take care of the acoustic treatment of the studio? Okay, James, first of all, thank you so much for submitting this question. I think it's a really good one and is probably relevant to a lot of people in our audience. Let me make 3 points here. The first one is, I want to walk you through the pros and cons of DIY acoustics versus hiring a specialist, because I think there are some dramatic differences between the two approaches. Then let me walk you through what I call the minimum effective studio treatment. So this is, yeah, kind of the Pareto principle or 80-20 of what you need to do to make your room sound decent. And then the last thing I want to address is my recommended way, which is what I call guided DIY. It's a mixture of the two. Okay, so what are the differences between DIY acoustics on the one hand and hiring an acoustic specialist on the other hand? Let's start with the specialist first and see what the pros are from this approach. So the first major upside of working with a specialist is obviously that you get reliable results. Short disclaimer, if you work with the right person, that's also really important. But generally speaking, if you hire a great acoustician, then you will get very reliable results that are only limited by, first of all, your budget, and secondly, the space that's available. Yeah? These are the only two limiting factors. Other than that, everything's possible, basically. Then the next big benefit is you can prove the success with before and after measurements. Yeah? It's hard to do these measurements correctly on your own. So very few people that are normal producers that can do reliable acoustic measurements and that really tell you something, because also the interpretation of what the graph tells you is super difficult. Yeah? It's not something that you just learn on the fly. And the last point, which I find very valuable, is you get to ask great questions. Yeah? So if you work with a specialist who has been studying this field for years, for decades maybe, and you are just starting out with acoustics and you want to learn more about that, obviously you get really great answers by these people if they're willing to share. Now let's come to the downsides of working with a specialist. And the first one, which I think is the most important one, is that you cannot even consider hiring a specialist below anything like 10K. And 10K is just the absolute bare minimum starting point for getting like a little bit of advice and maybe a few treatment modules, and that's it. Yeah. From that point on, you can spend unlimited amounts of money. Yeah. So if you look at the things that, for example, a firm like Northward Acoustics are doing, it's one of the major acoustic companies by Thomas Jean-Jean, they're treating studios from people like Skrillex and Deadmau5 and so on. And obviously they spend hundreds of thousands, if not millions, on their facilities. Yeah. And yeah, of course, anything in that range comes with a certain price. If you have certain expectations that you want to be fulfilled acoustically, then this is going to cost you serious money. Now, the second important downside is that it's not easy to find a great acoustician. Yeah, so there are a lot of people who claim to be great at studio acoustics and who have learned a lot of stuff on their own and read a lot of books and so on. And yes, some of them are great. Some of them are super well respected. But then there are also a lot of big mouths, in my opinion and in my experience, that are not really worth the money. Yeah, and this is dangerous, because if you spend serious cash on your studio treatment, and you work with someone who's probably really good at, yeah, self-promoting, but not actually that good when it comes to acoustics, or has a very opinionated approach about acoustics, then you can fall into this trap of believing the hype around a certain person and what they claim, but then basically waste money, because afterwards you're not really comfortable in that space, for example. This happens very often, that people have spend a lot of money on their studio, and then they're sitting there to actually produce, and they somehow feel that something's off, something's wrong, and it doesn't get better after a few weeks. It's a pretty good sign that they hired the wrong person. Another possibility is also that they suggest things that are impossible to you. So if you are limited by certain factors in your space, you're sharing with someone, or you're still maybe living with your parents and you want to get your acoustics to a new standard inside their basement or something like that, they might suggest something that is completely impossible to do because it means like tearing down some walls or building new walls or whatever it is. Yeah, and if that's just not possible for you, but they insist on doing that approach or nothing, then you will also have a very bad taste in your mouth. Now, let me tell you a little story. When I was still living with my parents and just starting out doing the studio thing like many, many years ago, I hired an acoustician by a company that I read about again and again, and they even published books about acoustics and so on. And I thought, yeah, they must be the major players in the game. Luckily, they were from my hometown, so it was relatively easy to get in touch and to have them come over and analyze my space and make suggestions. But then when the guy showed up, he was basically smelling like from alcohol. Yeah, so maybe he had a party the day before. I have no idea. Maybe he was just an alcoholic and this was part of his breakfast. No idea. But from the very beginning, I had the impression that he doesn't take me seriously as an upcoming producer. And that was pretty hard for me because he then sat down and made like a hand-drawn sketch of my room and what he would suggest, like which walls to build and what type of furniture should go where and what type of panels should be where. And it was just the standard approach that this company was selling again and again and again to all their clients. Well, it simply didn't work in my room, obviously, because I had to deal with my parents. I had to allow this kind of change in architecture, which didn't happen, of course. So in the end, I paid like $300 simply for a 1 hour consultation. Plus he also charged for the way to come to my place and the way back. And that for just having a chat with somebody, smelling of alcohol and not being taken seriously. I am really, really happy that I only spent like $300 at that time, which was a lot of money for me, like still studying and so on. But yeah, imagine spending like $30,000 or something on someone who doesn't give you the kind of workflow or the kind of results that you imagine to have. And that brings me to the last point here. You have to have an idea about certain room philosophies and why they are beneficial for a certain approach and not for the other approach. So, and these room philosophies, they are really important. They are certain acoustical directions or flavors that you can go into. There is no such thing as the one perfect acoustic way of doing things. Certain companies have different approaches and the rooms definitely sound different. They're not all flat, absolutely not. Some of them have very short reverb times, some of them a little bit longer, some of them take into account a lot of psychoacoustic factors, others not. That is something you have to educate yourself on first before then being able to hire the correct acoustician to do the work. Okay, let's now take a look at the DIY acoustics approach, because also there we have pros and cons. Let's start with the pros. So the first big benefit of doing the acoustics on your own is obviously the learning experience. And I don't want to miss that phase. Yeah. So all the absorbers in my studio, I built them completely on my own. And the only reason I was able to make the right decisions and also to know that, for example, the diffuser over there is something that I will probably buy. And I also knew that it will come very, very last in the process. It was not something super important at that point. To make these kinds of educated decisions, it was super important to first read a lot about acoustics, study the resources, know about the research behind things. And I don't want to miss this important learning experience. In a nutshell, it has helped me understand sound and the concepts behind how sound works in rooms. I think this is so valuable as a lesson. And if you do this on your own, the DIY acoustic approach, you will benefit from this learning experience. Then, of course, it is super cost effective. Yeah, so getting a basic treatment of a room, definitely below $5,000. Yeah, you can, with $5,000, you can do a lot. If you spend like $2,000 on your room, that's a very good starting point. And even below that, you can get started. Yeah, building panels on your own, if you have like a little bit of craftsmanship skills, then you will definitely be able to build panels. But of course, you have to do the research on where to place them, what materials to use, and all of that. Now, the last big benefit on the DIY side of acoustics is you have full control over all aspects of design and placement and so on. Because let's be honest, you don't want to work in a studio that just doesn't feel comfortable. If you spend a lot of time in your studio and everything's acoustically perfect, but you feel kind of uncomfortable in your space, yeah, of course that doesn't make sense. And sometimes the acousticians, the professional ones, will obviously recommend the thing that they were hired for, the best acoustic approach, yeah, the perfect thing for your room sonically. This might not be the perfect thing for you to actually put out great music and be creative. And as a creator, I would always highlight this aspect of being in a space that's comfortable, that is facilitating creativity as a whole. I would always emphasize this aspect over having perfect sound, because even less than perfect sound, if it's good enough at a certain level, will still help you put out better sounding music. Just to get this straight, your mind is also helping you with this. Yeah, your brain is deciphering acoustics and making adjustments to how you perceive things. And even in a less than ideal room, you can still put out amazing music. Okay, so let's now talk about the downsides of the DIY approach. First of all, I think what we have to keep in mind is that it can get overwhelming pretty quickly. The thing is, there's so much research going on and so many conflicting opinions on forums and so on, that it's really hard to find out on your own what is the best way of doing things. And just in that moment where you think, now I figured it out, you read of something else that completely contradicts that point. And it takes some time to get to that level where you can actually, find out, okay, who's right in this discussion, or what makes sense for your specific situation. Let's maybe put it like this. And beware of forums. You can learn a lot on forums like earsluts.com, for example. They have a dedicated acoustics forum, and it's great to absorb all the knowledge in there. And there are some really fascinating people that have done great work and they know their stuff. But then obviously there are also a lot of people on forums who have a very big mouth and not that much of an educated opinion, I would say. So definitely try to figure out which sources you want to trust and which ones you don't want to trust. And of course, if you are able to read, for example, scientific papers and stuff like that, published by the Audio Engineering Society or any other trusted source of information, that is probably the area where you will get the most educated opinion from. And also very established acoustics firms, they also have like certain FAQ pages or blogs on how acoustics work and so on. I think these are also great resources to dive into. Now, the second big downside to the DIY approach is that you don't know what you don't know. So if you try to figure out how to treat your room, and you have done your research and you know, okay, this is probably the way that I should take, there might still be something that you're completely unaware of, where a professional acoustician would immediately jump at and say, for your specific situation, this acoustic phenomenon occurs and this is why you cannot use that treatment technique. And for you, that's obviously hard to judge. You have no idea of what you don't know. You don't know what you don't know. That's the problem here. And there's no solution to this, except for what I'm going to talk about a little bit later. Now, the third big downside here is it takes a lot of time and energy. So even if you save a lot of money with a DIY approach, it still means that you have to invest a lot of time and a lot of effort into building these things and to, first of all, do your research before you can even start building things. So if you want to go completely DIY, then definitely set aside a lot of time to actually educate yourself and then build the different acoustic modules and place them. It's gonna take way longer than you think. I've done the same thing with my studio and it has taken way longer than I had anticipated. And of course, during that time, I wasn't able to work with clients. And in that way, you can also say I spent a lot of money because I didn't make money in that time. So to answer James's question in a nutshell, should you hire an acoustic specialist or not? Well, I think it depends. Probably not if you don't have a lot of extra money to spend, which I assume that for anyone who's just starting out, they haven't saved up a ton of money to invest into their acoustic treatment. I think you will only be able to pick the right person and to make that serious investment if you have already some DIY experience, because only then you can ask the right questions and go for the right room philosophy and so on, or at least discuss these topics and find the right person to then fulfill your needs. So if hiring a specialist is probably not the best option, what does this path of DIY acoustics now look like for you? Let me walk you through what I call the minimum effective studio treatment. So before we go into studio treatment, let me just put this here as a short disclaimer. I think that with a decent pair of headphones, like something like $150 to whatever, $300 or something, in that range you will get a very decent pair of headphones, and then also you can get something like the Sonarworks headphone correction software. With these two things, you can make awesome sounding mixes and masters. It takes a bit of training, absolutely, but it's going to be better than like a shitty acoustic treatment, basically. There are obviously two problems with that. The first one is, it just feels very exhausting to work on headphones all day. So if you really spend a lot of time working with music, headphones is probably not the solution for every day, but it can be a really good solution for a certain period of time. And the second thing is, you are usually not getting a correct stereo image, because having two cans on your ears is a very different thing if the sound comes from completely left and completely right, compared to sitting in a triangle with speakers and some like distance between you and the speakers. And that is a very different feel of the stereo image. So judging how far things are panned out is very different on headphones compared to studio speakers. When it then comes to acoustic treatment in your room, I want you to think about leverage first. Leverage means what has the highest impact with like the minimum thing you have to put in. What is giving you the best return on investment, basically, of your time, of your money, of all the resources that are available to you. So if you look at this little drawing here, which is by my friend Jesko Lohan, who runs a site called acousticsinsider.com, which I really recommend you check out, it's fantastic. This little drawing here explains super effectively on what you should focus on first and how you can move up the chain of effectiveness, basically. So you start with something called the room preparation, which just means what is the room like, which rooms are available to you, and what can you do with a bare room to improve things first of all. And then you can move on to sweet spot and speaker placement, because already just by placing yourself in the right spot in this room and placing the speakers correctly gives you a super high return on investment, because what do you invest in except a little bit of time of checking out what works best in your room. And yes, it makes sense to experiment with this first before putting any treatment inside this room. Then obviously broadband absorption is the next super effective thing you need to do. Then you can go into something like tuned absorbers, which are targeting very specific frequencies, and then you move on to diffusion. Now, what a lot of people do wrong here is they think, oh wow, this diffuser looks so cool. Let me start with this because it does this super advanced, tricky thing called the diffusion that I really don't understand. But yeah, I will go for that because it looks great. Really bad idea. Really, really bad idea. It gives you a super limited bandwidth, almost no acoustic benefit in most rooms, especially not if they're too small. And there are a lot of reasons not to start with diffusion at all for a very long time. Then they think like, oh yeah, I've read about this cool Helmholtz resonator, which is targeting exactly my 80 hertz problem that I have in my room. Well, it turns out it's super hard to build a Helmholtz resonator on your own, and most of the time it's completely the wrong frequency that you're targeting. So again, like, why should you start with that? It does not make sense. So let me quickly walk you through what I call the minimum effective studio treatment here. First of all, educate yourself, super important. I suggest you start with something like acousticsinsider.com. It's a trusted resource because I know the guy who produces that content. He has also helped me build my room and we've been friends for a long time now. I can definitely recommend him. Then the next thing is you need to experiment with your listening position, experiment with your speaker placement, and also sometimes experiment with where to place your traps. I mean, there are certain recommendations on where to start placing your traps, but still there is some room to negotiate, especially if you have something like a window on the one side, for example. Sometimes it can be great to leave that window completely untreated, and in other scenarios it makes sense to completely put absorbers in front of that window, and you will only find out by actually experimenting and trusting your gut feeling of how does it actually sound in that room. Then I recommend you start treating the early reflection points. So early reflection points is like between you and the speakers directly. The left wall between you and the speaker, the right wall between you and the speaker, the ceiling, which is obviously a first reflection point between you and the speakers. And if you have treated these points, you will get a very, very accurate stereo image, which is a great starting point, even if you still have bass problems, of course, at this point. But then you can move on to treating the room corners. Yeah, the room corners are also giving you a very good ratio of effectiveness. If you completely cover your all four main corners of the room, floor to ceiling, with insulation material, like the right kind of insulation material, something really important to pay attention to, then of course you will get a really dramatic improvement on your bass response. What's also super important for the minimum effective studio treatment is to focus on broadband absorption. And with broadband absorption, I mean, it starts at bass frequencies and it covers the entire frequency spectrum until the very top end of the frequency spectrum. Of course, the effectiveness below 200 Hertz is not going to be as great. So every acoustics material that you use for broadband absorption kind of, has a little dip in effectiveness. But that still doesn't mean you should use tuned absorbers instead, because they are really hard to get right, even if it means that they target a specific bass problem that you have in your room. Stick with broadband absorption. This is giving you the best bang for buck, and it will dramatically improve the bass response of your room. And lastly, please simply forget about diffusers and tuned bass traps. Just doesn't make sense at this point for you. Just start with the minimum acoustic treatment that I've laid out here and you will be fine. Yeah. Then you can slowly optimize it from there on and see if something else makes sense for you. Now, I also recommend you use this in combination with Sonarworks. Sonarworks is a room correction software. There are also competitors out there, but I use Sonarworks. I haven't tested the other ones and I'm really happy with this product. I think that Sonarworks really can improve your overall sound that comes out of the speakers because, Sonarworks is not a room correction software. It does not anything to your room. It basically corrects what comes out of the speakers in relation to what is happening in the room. So that's really important. And Sonarworks is definitely giving you a great upgrade on the whole acoustic ecosystem in your room. Bear in mind though that this is not a solution for a completely untreated room. They try to sell it as like the go-to solution even if for a completely untreated room. It's not the case. In my experience, Sonarworks works best when it's used in a at least minimally treated room. So let's come to the third and final point here I want to make, and that is you can do something that is a hybrid between the two approaches, between hiring a specialist and DIY acoustic treatment, and that is what I call guided DIY. And guided DIY makes so much sense because you pay a professional to then build it on your own. So you pay for their expertise, they will tell you what you don't know, but should know maybe, and you can have this back and forth, they giving you really great advice, you implementing it, then maybe if they're in your area, you can even do measurements together before and after and to see if the effectiveness is there. That is, to me, the most effective approach in terms of what you get for your money. And what's super important here is you can obviously buy absorbers from the shelf, but they are going to be a little bit more expensive. If you have the time and like minimum craftsmanship skill, you can definitely build these bass traps or broadband absorbers on your own and still get kind of the professional advice from an acoustician. I think this is the best bang for buck ratio overall, and you also learn something on the fly. I think that's the best investment for you overall. Okay, that's it for this question. Thank you so much for submitting it. Let me know in the comments if you found this helpful, and if you also want to get help from me directly in video form, then just submit your question to philip@pickyourself.com. I'm super excited to hear from you, and I can't wait to jump into the next video for you. Until then, bye-bye.